Well, good morning and welcome to LifePoint Church Online. We are so glad that you could join us from wherever you are and so thankful that you invited us into your home this morning. We are excited about today's service and to worship our Lord and King. As you have joined us, just a few things that I want you to be aware about if you kind of get familiar with the platform. First off, we'd love for you to jump in the chat and let us know that you joined us. Say good morning to everyone. It's great to see who is with us and to say hello. And so I encourage you to do that. As well as there are some links that we'd like to point your attention to. One is the connection card. If you wouldn't mind just clicking that link and be sure to fill it out. Let us know who's joining us. It's great just to know who is worshiping with us. And so if you could do that. Also, there's a giving link. Many of you are continue to be faithful in supporting our mission as a church and the ministry that we're doing in our community, and just say thank you for that. But if you're unsure of how to get that, there are three easy ways. One is online. There's a give link that you can do. You can put it in the mail, send it to the office, or even bring it by the office later this week. And so just, again, want to say thank you for all those who are supporting us in this time. Also, there's a link for the bulletin. So up at the top or maybe down below the video, there is a bulletin link. Be sure to click that. There's some things that are coming up, and be sure to read what's going on there. Also, if you are new, if this is your first time joining us online, we want to say welcome and so glad that you are here. There is a link there that says I'm new. And if you wouldn't mind clicking that and filling that out, we'd love to get in touch and know how we can serve you best during this time. Well, wouldn't it be nice if you got all the things that you need to know in one email one time a week? Wouldn't that be great? Well, in regards to the things that are happening at the church, that is what's happening. On Tuesdays, typically, we send one weekly email out for you to know what's going on now, what's coming up, how to find the links to the service, and it's all you need to know in that one email. So be sure to look for that in your inbox. If you are having trouble or you're not in that email list, if in the connection card there's a question that says, how can we serve you? Go ahead and put your email and say, hey, I'd like to get signed up for that weekly email. You put that in there, we will be able to follow up with you and get you into that email. Well, one thing that is coming up is Christmas Eve, and we are so excited about our Christmas Eve service. It'll be a little bit different this year. We'll be streaming it online and encourage you to join us, you and your family. You can pick a time, either 4 o'clock or 8 o'clock, whatever's most convenient for your home and your day on Christmas Eve. And so we'd encourage you to join us and also know that you can send invites out to anyone. I mean, it's easier to join our Christmas Eve service than ever before, and would love to anyone that you know that could use some encouragement, could use a reminder of the reason for this season, we'd love for them to join us. And we'd encourage you to direct them to a website called ChristmasInGoshen.com. I'll say it again, ChristmasInGoshen, one word, .com. And that has all of the details about our service for Christmas Eve, how to join us online, as well as there are the links to all of our Advent resources. So the Jesse Tree Family Devotionals, the Jesse Tree Adult Devotionals, the Wreath Guide, all of that can be found at ChristmasInGoshen.com. So I encourage you to go there and check that out. Well, last week we talked a lot about darkness, and it was really, really happy sermon, and you're probably feeling really encouraged by the end of it. But today we turn a corner, and today we're going to be lighting the candle of joy. And there is this time when Israel came back into Jerusalem from exile, and they were reading the scriptures, and they began to feel really aware of their darkness and how they were walking in darkness. And they felt very sorrowful and very sad about how they had been living. And Nehemiah says this. He says, don't grieve. Don't grieve, because actually the joy of the Lord is our strength. And you don't grieve the darkness because God has come and he is coming to be with us. And that joy that we can find in the Lord is our strength. The grace that he shows us that we don't have to stay in the dark is the joy that gives us strength through the dark times. And so I hope you turn the corner with us this morning and that you will sing in your homes and that you would worship our God, a joyous celebration of a God who has come with us, who's not left us in the dark, that we can worship and praise him in the light. Let's worship.
We light these candles as a sign of our joy in the beauty of things this season. Not just the things that glitter and flash, but the deeper things. The beauty of the heart and the soul. The beauty of love shared in service and hospitality. The beauty of good news for the poor. The captives released. The beauty of salvation through Christ Jesus. We light this candle of joy because God is with us. Too often we think of joy as something big. Oh God, a brass band or a parade can certainly bring us joy. Just as easily and far more often, we can feel joy through a hug or a squeeze of the hand. We can see joy in a smile or hear it in laughter. Help us to not overlook the simple joys that speak into our lives daily. This week, in our Advent journey, open our eyes to joy.
Our Jesse Tree reading for today comes from 1 Kings. So it's a selection from 1 Kings 18. It's not the whole verses that you see there, but just some parts of it. So this is what it says. At the time of the offering of the oblation, the prophet Elijah came near and said, O Lord, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, let it be known this day that you are God in Israel, that I am your servant, and that I have done all these things at your bidding. Answer me, O Lord, answer me, so that this people may know that you, O Lord, are God, and that you have turned their hearts back. The fire of the Lord fell and consumed the burnt offering, the wood, the stones, and the dust, and even licked up the water that was in the trench. When all the people saw it, they fell on their faces and said, This Lord indeed is God. This Lord indeed is God. A time of prayer now, so I would encourage you just to relax, to bow your head, to open up your posture to the Holy Spirit this morning as we come to the Father in prayer. God, this morning we give you all glory, we give you all praise, we give you all honor. God, we recognize that you made the biggest sacrifice in sending your Son. That as a little baby, you entered our world. And you did it just to save us, Lord. So God, we give you honor this morning. We give you praise. God with us, Emmanuel, hope of everything created from thy throne to Bethlehem. God, we know that that is not a small thing. That's not a light encounter, God. So we just thank you and we offer praise to you this morning for that. God, in this time of preparing for your son to come, God, we take this moment to prepare our hearts to confess to you the things that don't line with where your heart is, God. God, we just take this moment to silently lift those things up to you, to say, Father, please forgive us. Jesus, we know that it is only by you entering this world that we can find the grace that you offer. Jesus, we accept that grace this morning. We accept your open, loving arms saying, you are my child. We accept your forgiveness this morning, God. Father, I just want to pray over our church this morning, those that call LifePoint their home. God, we're all preparing for a Christmas that just looks different this year. For some, it's a really tough season every year. But God, this year, it's a tough season for all of us. So God, I just pray for all of us that you would give us just strength for it and endurance. Give us joy in this season. When it feels dark, when it might feel like all hope is lost, Father, we just pray for your joy, that we can find hope in the little things. But ultimately, Father, we find hope in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. God, I just pray for Elkhart County. Lord, as we find ourselves in the midst of a COVID spike, God, we pray for your mercy. We pray just for health in our county, God, and in our city. Father, we pray for a cure. We pray your blessing, your hand over the immunizations that are emerging, Father. Oh, God, would they just bring health? Would you continue to be over the minds of the doctors that are doing the research and that are creating these immunizations? God, we just pray for your just your hand in this, God. I know that you're with us. I know that you're always there, and I know that you're always working. But God, would you just continue to move in mighty ways when it comes to this virus? Father, this morning we lift up New Horizon Ministries. God, would you bless them? Would you give them strength and endurance in this season to continue the ministry that you've called them to? God, we just pray for your peace to wash over them this morning and their leaders. God, continue to empower them, again, to just do the ministry that you have called them to, the specific thing that you've empowered them to do. Father, this morning we say, Holy Spirit, come. Holy Spirit, fill this place, fill the homes of everyone who's watching this morning. Fill the hearts of those who have tuned in. Holy Spirit, we declare that we are listening, that we're open, that we're ready to receive your word this morning. God, I pray for Pastor Troy this morning as he comes to bring that word. That again, we pray every week that, Father, would you do what only you are capable of taking the words that come out of his mouth, and as they land on our ears and our hearts, Father, would you transform us? Holy Spirit, transform us this morning. Jesus, it's in your precious name that we pray. Amen.
I am so glad that you are with us today. And if we haven't met yet, my name is Troy Scott, and I am the pastor pastor here at LifePoint Church. And again, especially if you're here with us for the first time, or maybe the second or third time, so glad that you have joined with us in worship today. Well, the good news that I want to share with you today is this. God is with us and for us in the darkness. God is with us and for us in the darkness. Isn't that great news for the dark times that we are living in? And yet, I don't know about you, it's not uncommon to feel God's presence, the least, in the midst of the darkness of life. I mean, have you ever gone through a dark season of life and felt like God was nowhere to be found? Me too. I felt that myself. And the truth is that many of us, I think, have probably felt that way this year. Last week, Zach did a great job of getting our series, God With Us, started. And he focused on us. The part of that phrase, God with us, it was us. And he wisely pointed this out. Nobody likes being left in the dark. And I agree with him wholeheartedly. Nobody likes being left in the dark. And Zach explained that God provides a way out of the darkness, both the darkness that is outside of us, like the gloom that we're experiencing this year from a pandemic, as well as the darkness within us, those sinful, ugly things that we would just prefer for nobody to know about, that God actually provides a way for us out of that darkness. And that way, that light, is Jesus. And here's what I would add to what he said last week. Nobody likes being left alone in the dark. How about you? I mean, I hate to be alone in the dark, especially here in our church building. I'm guessing that not very many of you have wandered around our church building in the darkness, but I have. And there are all kinds of noises that happen in this building, as it creaks and moans as it gets older and older. And there are times when you're here in the dark and you hear a creak or a moan and you can become convinced that there's somebody else here with you. And it kind of gets a little creepy and a little spooky because nobody likes to be left alone in the dark. Wandering through life in the dark is hard enough, but to do it alone, I'm convinced that's just brutal. And that's why our good news for today is so important, that God is with us in our darkness. Even when we don't feel him present, he is with us. Just because it feels like God isn't with you doesn't mean it's true. We see this in the text that we're focusing on right now, Isaiah chapter 9, verses 1 through 7. And my focus for today is verses 3 through 5. But I'm actually going to read from verse 1 all the way through verse 6 for some context for you. So Isaiah chapter 9, verses 1 through 6. This is what it says about what Isaiah says. Nevertheless, that time of darkness and despair will not go on forever. The land of Zebulun and Naphtali will be humbled, but there will be a time in the future when the Galilee of the Gentiles, which lies along the road that runs between the Jordan and the sea, will be filled with glory. The people who walk in darkness will see a great light. For those who live in a land of deep darkness, a light will shine. You will enlarge the nation of Israel and its people will rejoice. They will rejoice before you as people rejoice at the harvest, like warriors dividing the plunder. For you will break the yoke of their slavery and lift the heavy burden from their shoulders. You will break the oppressor's rod, just as you did when you destroyed the army of Midian. The boots of the warrior and the uniforms bloodstained by war will be burned. They will be fuel for the fire. For a child is born to us, a son is given to us, and the government will rest on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. What we're focusing on today is verses 3 through 5. And I think after reading verses 1 through 6, those first three verses are verses that we can really relate to right now. This talking about darkness, and yet there's joy that we're experiencing. And the reason I think we can relate to that is that COVID-19 has brought darkness and gloom and grief to our world this year. But now a light has shined. Vaccines are being approved and rolled out. And there's a light at the end of what has seemed like a very long tunnel. Imagine the joy that we're going to be experiencing next summer, and maybe even into late winter this year, realizing that it's almost over. It's that kind of joy that God's people were experiencing there in verse 3, because a light was shining. They'd been stumbling around in the darkness, weighed down by the trouble that they'd gotten themselves into and filled with despair over a powerful army invading them. And Isaiah says, a light has shined. But what does that mean? A light has shined. What kind of light? Well, Isaiah tells us in verse 6 that a child is born. A son is given. And verses 6 through 7 likely have a double meaning. These two verses are likely pointing to two different kings, Hezekiah and Jesus. The king at the time that Isaiah wrote this was Ahaz, and he was a rotten king. And many of his choices to turn from God and towards the ways of the world led to the darkness that the people were living in. But eventually, Ahaz has a son, Hezekiah. And Hezekiah became a great and godly king, leading God's people and bringing light into their dark. Only Kings David and Solomon are more respected than Hezekiah. And here's what 2 Kings chapter 18, verses 5 through 17 say about him. It says, Hezekiah trusted in the Lord, the God of Israel. There was no one like him among all the kings of Judah, either before or after his time. He remained faithful to the Lord in everything. And he carefully obeyed all the commands the Lord had given Moses. So the Lord was with him, and Hezekiah was successful in everything he did. Now, there's no doubt that Hezekiah was a great king. But I'm also sure that Isaiah chapter 9, verses 6 and 7 isn't just about Hezekiah. I'm confident that the ultimate king that brings light to shine in our darkness is Jesus. He is God with us, a light shining in our darkness. And Jesus even begins his ministry with these verses in Isaiah 9, found in Matthew chapter 4, verses 12 through 17. Those verses say, when Jesus heard that John had been arrested, he left Judea and returned to Galilee. And he went first to Nazareth, and then from there moved to Capernaum, beside the Sea of Galilee, in the region of Zebulun and Naphtali. This fulfilled what God had said through the prophet Isaiah. In the land of Zebulun and Naphtali, beside the sea beyond the Jordan River in Galilee, where so many Gentiles live, the people who sat in darkness had seen a great light. And for those who lived in the land where death cast its shadows, a light has shined. From then on, Jesus began to preach, repent of your sins and turn to God, for the kingdom of heaven is near. Whenever Jesus says kingdom of heaven or kingdom of God has come near, that's his way of saying God has come near to you in me. In Jesus, God has come to be with us. And here's something I really want you to hear today. God with us is not just the story of Christmas. God with us is the entire story of the Bible. It is the story of the first book of Genesis, and it's the story of the last book of the Bible, Revelation. In Genesis 1 through 3, we read about God creating the world. And when he creates human beings, he does it in a very personal way, molding us and breathing life into us. Not only that, but in Genesis 3, it suggests that God actually came to the garden where he had created the humans, Adam and Eve, and he took an evening walk with Adam and Eve. Unfortunately, if you read further in Genesis 3, you realize that Adam and Eve, and all the rest of us as well, messed up God with us by rejecting him and his ways and choosing to go our own way. But here's the amazing thing about God. The rest of the story is about him finding a way to be with us. The people that he created and the people that rejected him, that said, you know what, we'd rather not be with you. He goes to incredible lengths to find ways to be with us. Here's just one of hundreds of examples of God with us in the Bible. And it's actually a passage that I'm working on memorizing right now because it's so powerful. Isaiah 43 verses 1 through 2 says, "But now, O Jacob, listen to the Lord who created you. O Israel, the one who formed you says, 'Do not be afraid, for I have ransomed you. I have called you by name. You are mine. When you go through deep waters, I will be with you. When you go through the rivers of difficulty, you will not drown. When you walk through the fire of oppression, you will not be burned up. The flames will not consume you.'" Well, then, from the Old Testament, which is what Isaiah is in, we get to the New Testament, where we begin to learn about Jesus. And especially in Matthew, I want you to listen to how Matthew begins and ends this story about Jesus. First, as the angel of the Lord is explaining who Jesus is to Mary and Joseph, Jesus' parents, in Matthew 1:20-23. He says, "As he considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream. 'Joseph, son of David,' the angel said, 'do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child within her was conceived by the Holy Spirit. And she will have a son, and you are to name him Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins.' All of this occurred to fulfill the Lord's message through his prophet: 'Look, the virgin will conceive a child, she will give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel,' which means 'God is with us.'" Now, I want you to listen to how Matthew's story of Jesus closes in Matthew 28, verses 18 through 20. These are the very last verses of Jesus' life in Matthew. It says, "Jesus came and told his disciples, 'I have been given all authority in heaven and on earth. Therefore, go and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Teach these new disciples to obey all the commands I have given you, and be sure of this: I am with you always, even to the end of the age." So Matthew starts out with God with us, and he ends with God with us. Jesus is with us even now through his Holy Spirit. But it doesn't end there. I said earlier that it's even about God with us is even about Revelation. And so listen to Revelation 21, verses 1 through 3. John the writer says, "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the old heaven and the old earth had disappeared, and the sea was also gone. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven like a bride beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud shout from the throne saying, 'Look, God's home is now among us, his people. He will live with them and they will be his people. God himself will be with them.'" This is God's great desire. He wants to be with you. He wants to be with me. He wants to be with us. God is always present in your life. He's always moving toward you. God is always glad to be with you. So in light of this, I want to ask a couple of questions. If the whole story of the Bible is God wants to be with us, how often are we actually aware of God's presence in our life? And why does it seem sometimes like he's not present at all? How often are you actually aware of God's presence in your life, and why does it sometimes feel like he's not present at all? I'm convinced one of the ultimate invitations of Christianity is God inviting us into a divine union with him that awakens us to and makes us aware of his presence more and more, moment by moment. It's literally what we are made for. So why do we struggle with knowing God's presence with us? Well, the reason we struggle is on us. It is not on God. God is always glad to be with you. He is always moving toward you. He's not keeping distance from you out of disappointment or anger or disgust because of something you did. The problem is that we choose to wander away. Just as Adam and Eve rejected God's way and hid from his presence, we turn away from God's path to life and wander away from him as well. Zach did a great job last week of explaining that the people wandering in darkness here in Isaiah 9 were wandering in darkness because they had rejected God and his ways. And you see this in Isaiah 7 and 8. The world superpower at the time was Assyria. And their king had invaded and conquered the kingdom just north of God's people. And now Assyria was threatening God's people too as well. And they and their king Ahab had a choice to make. Would they turn to God and his power and his ways, or would they wander away by taking their own path? And I want to share with you just a few passages from Isaiah 8, starting at verses 5 and 6, and hear how they rejected God. God is speaking through Isaiah here, starting at verse 5. He says, "Then the Lord spoke to me again and said, 'My care for the people of Judah is like the gently flowing waters of Shiloh, but they have rejected it.' Then down in verse 11, 'The Lord has given me a strong warning not to think like everyone else does.' He said, 'Don't call everything a conspiracy like they do, and don't live in dread of what frightens them. Make the Lord of heaven's army holy in your life. He is the one you should fear. He is the one you should make, who should make you tremble. He will keep you safe.' And then down in verses 19 through 22, it says, 'Someone may say to you, let's ask the mediums and those who consult the spirits of the dead with their whisperings and mutterings. They will tell us what to do.' But shouldn't people ask God for guidance? Shouldn't the living seek guidance from the dead? Look to God's instructions and teachings. People who contradict his word are completely in the dark. They will go from one place to another, weary and hungry, and because they are hungry, they will rage and curse their king and their God. They will look up to heaven and down to earth, but wherever they look, there will be trouble and anguish and dark despair. They will be thrown out into the darkness." God is inviting them through Isaiah to turn to him for care, to call out to him for guidance and help. But the people reject him and instead turn to fortune tellers and spirits of the dead. God offers light, and we choose darkness. This is what King Ahaz and the people chose in Isaiah 7 and 8. And it's what we choose as well. Whether it's fear by not trusting God or rejecting God and his ways because we think we know better, we turn away from God and his presence. And the result is a darkness. A darkness of slavery to sin and fear. A darkness of a life weighed down by burdens. A darkness of a life filled with oppression. And we find ourselves stuck living in darkness, a life without God. But as Isaiah 9:1 says, nevertheless, God is passionate about being with us. And so he will go to radical efforts to make it possible for us to return to him and be with him. Isaiah 4 and 5 again say, "For you will break the yoke of their slavery and lift the heavy burden from their shoulders. You will break the oppressor's rod just as you did when you destroyed the army of Midian. The boots of the warrior and the uniforms bloodstained by war will all be burned. They will be fuel for the fire." God is willing to get into our mess and do something about it. He is committed to coming after us and coming near to us in Jesus to break us free from the slavery and oppression that we've created for ourselves so we can come back to him and enjoy his presence. Well, how does he do this? How does he break us free? Well, again, it's Jesus. Jesus says this about himself in Luke chapter 4, verses 16 through 20. Jesus is in the temple, and he's been handed a scroll from Isaiah, and he unrolled the scroll and found the place where this was written. "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, for he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim that captives will be released, and that the blind will see, that the oppressed will be set free, and that the time of the Lord's favor has come." He rolled up the scroll, handed it back to the attendant, and sat down. All eyes in the synagogue looked at him intently, and then he began to speak to them. "The scripture you just heard has been fulfilled this very day." Jesus said, "I came to set people free." But Jesus isn't the only one that talked about it. Paul, one of Jesus' earliest followers, wrote this about him in Colossians chapter 1, verses 13 through 14. He said, "For he has rescued us from the kingdom of darkness and transferred us into the kingdom of his dear Son, who purchased our freedom and forgave our sins. Paul says this about Jesus in Ephesians chapter 1, verses 6 through 8. So we praise God for the glorious grace he has poured out on us who belong to his dear son. He is so rich in kindness and grace that he purchased our freedom with the blood of his son and forgave our sins. He has showered his kindness on us along with all wisdom and understanding. Jesus purchased our freedom. He set us free by the power of his death on the cross. God wants to be with us so badly. He became one of us in Jesus, and he is willing to do whatever it takes to set us free from the yoke of slavery to sin, the heavy burden of sin, the oppression of sin that we choose on our own. He will do anything to be with us, including dying a brutal death on a cross. When Jesus did that, he allowed the evil powers of the world to pour on all the dark wickedness that the world creates through our sin, and through his death, he broke its power. And he broke our yoke of slavery and oppression to sin. Because God wants to be with us, God is always glad to be with us. I understand that sometimes the darkness around us is dark. And it's so dark, it's disorienting. And it makes it hard to be aware that God is with us. I've been there myself, especially in this difficult year. Mental health, I think, all throughout America has been a huge struggle for a lot of people. Especially for people like me who already struggle with mental health issues. And here's what I know. God is with us whether it feels like it or not. God is with me and you in our darkness. In fact, I would say especially in the dark. He's there, moving towards us. It's up to us to slow down and pay attention. It's up to us to become aware of him. Now, one way that I've slowed down to pay attention to his presence with me has been to start meditating. In the last few months, I've been practicing meditation a few times a day for 10 or 15 minutes in the early morning and then just for a few minutes before lunch and in the late afternoon. Meditation is prayer that stops talking and pays attention for God's presence in my life. And just this week, God made me aware of his presence in a couple of different situations. At one point, in late morning, I was meditating for just a few minutes, and the whole point of my meditation was to slow down, to get quiet, to breathe deeply, and to ask God to just give me a word or a phrase that I could use to focus in on him and his presence with me. And as I listened, he said to me, "Let it go." I heard that phrase, "Let it go." And so I just kind of dwelled on it for a little while longer and kind of was done with it. Later on that afternoon, I was having a conversation with a friend, talking through an issue that I've just really been struggling with, a thing that has just been weighing heavily on me. And as I was explaining to my friend what was going on and my struggle and what had been weighing on me heavily, he kind of stopped me, kind of almost when I was done, and it seemed like I was going to continue going, and he stopped me and he said, "Troy, I want to say three words to you right now. Let it go." And I became so aware of God's goodness and his presence in my life in that moment that just a few hours after he had given me that phrase, "Let it go," he brought it back to me that afternoon and made me aware that he is with me. A couple days later, I was in my office early and I was spending a little longer time meditating. And I was just trying to focus on God and just saying, "God, I want to be aware of you with me right now." And about 5 minutes in, the phrase that came to me was from Numbers chapter 6, where there's this blessing that the priests are to give the people, where the blessing is, "May the Lord make his face shine upon you." And that picture came to me, and I began to get this sudden image of God smiling on me that day. And I just rested in that moment. And there was a warm presence, a thick presence of God with me as I rested in his smile on me. I became aware of his presence with me. But God isn't just with me. God is with you. God is with us. God is with us in the dark, shining his light so we can come back to him. It's one thing to believe God exists. It's transformative to believe God is near. Everything changes when we believe God wants to be with us and is glad to be with us. And so I wonder this morning, can we become glad to be with him? If God is so glad to be with us, can we become glad to be with him to the point that we are discontent unless we are aware of his presence with us, unless we are with him? Some of you know this, but our beloved dog, Dottie, who we had to lay to rest this past May, is a great model for this kind of discontent. Dottie had a great desire to be with her people. She would follow us around the house. Wherever we would go, she would be where we were at. In whatever room we were in, she would come and find us. And if there was a door closed, well, that was completely unacceptable because she wanted to be with her people. There would be scratching on the door until we opened it. You couldn't go to the bathroom without a scratch at the door or a nose sniffing under the crack to see who was in that room that she wanted to be with. God, she wanted to be with us. She was convinced that she belonged in our presence, and she was discontent with anything that separated us from her. She knew that she belonged in our presence. We belong in God's presence. He has made it possible for us to be with him through Jesus. So I wonder, can we become discontent when there's anything that separates us and keeps us from being with him? I wonder, can we be people who are convinced that God is with us, even and especially in the dark? Can we be people who are convinced God is always glad to be with us and that we belong in his presence? Can we be people who are discontent unless we are aware of God's presence in our lives? I want to invite you to bow your heads and to close your eyes. I just want to give you a brief moment here to listen. Pay attention. Become aware of God's presence with you right now. How is God speaking to you? How is he inviting you to become aware of his presence with you? What is God doing in you or your life right now? What are you going to do about it? Heavenly Father, Lord Jesus, Holy Spirit, we are so grateful that you are God with us, that you are glad to be with us, that you want desperately to be with us, that you'll do anything to get close to us. Father, thank you for being that God who doesn't give up on us, even when we reject you, even when we turn away from you, even when we go our own way and wander away from you. Thank you, God, that you are always coming to us. Father, we are so grateful that we can experience your presence. So, Lord, I pray right now for those that are struggling in the dark, to not be aware and that aren't able to feel your presence or experience your presence. Lord, I pray that that truth that you are with them, even in the dark, would become true to them right now, that you would help them to become aware of your presence. Father, I also pray for those who have never said yes to your offer, your invitation to be with you always and forever. That, Lord, they would right now admit that they need what Jesus did for them on the cross, that they need the forgiveness that comes from Jesus' shed blood and broken body, and that they would say yes to that invitation right now. They would confess that they've wandered away from you, they've chosen their own way, they've rejected you, they've lived life without you, but they're ready to live life with you now. Father, may all of us experience the joy that comes from being with you and your glad presence in our lives. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
That mourns in lonely exile here, until the Son of God appears. Rejoice, rejoice.
We're going to receive communion now. Communion is this incredible time when we remember Jesus' death on the cross. Jesus taught us to do this. And he probably did to help us remember God's presence with us. It's because of Jesus' death on the cross that we're able to draw near to God. And we remember Jesus' death on the cross by taking a couple of symbols of his body. One is the bread, which represents his body broken. And the other is his blood, which is represented by the juice that we drink today. Here's a powerful explanation of why these elements and their reminder of what Jesus did for us on the cross from Ephesians chapter 2. Paul writes, "You lived in this world without God and without hope, but now you have been united. Once you were far away from God, but now you have been brought near to him through the blood of Jesus Christ." So on the last night of Jesus' life, as he was eating a meal with his disciples, took a loaf of bread and lifted it up and gave thanks for it, he said, "This is my body. broken for you. After dinner, he took the cup, and in the same way, he lifted it up. And he said, "This cup represents the shedding of my blood and the sealing of the covenant between God and you. As often as you drink it, do this in remembrance of me." Would you pray with me? Jesus, we come to you today, and we ask that all that is you would flow into us. Jesus, may your body and blood be our food and drink. Jesus, may your passion and death be our strength and life. And Jesus, with you by our side, enough has been given. Help us to acknowledge that, Lord. May the shelter that we seek be the shadow of your cross. And Jesus, help us not to wander from the loving presence that you offer. Jesus, keep us from the evil that draws us away from you. And keep calling us, Jesus, to your presence until that day comes when, with all your saints, we may praise you forever. Jesus, we pray this in your strong name. Amen. Well, I hope you will join us next Sunday as we continue to prepare our hearts and lives for the coming of Jesus into our world. And as you go, I want to share this blessing with you from Numbers chapter 6 that I mentioned earlier. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Amen. You are loved, friends. Go in peace.
All ye faithful, joy.